Hello students, today I have come up with the next part of the chapter Chemical Bonding from class 11 syllabus. Okay, so today we are supposed to start with coordinate bond. So in class 10 you have learned that what is a coordinate bond. A coordinate bond is basically formed by the donation of a single lone pair from a donor atom to the acceptor atom. Okay, so let's start with the coordinate bonding. Okay, so coordinate bonding is basically if I consider the atoms which are involved in the bonding of two molecules. I am not considering the entire molecule, I am just considering the two atoms which are involved in the coordinate bonding. Okay, so if I consider A as the donor atom, then if two electrons need to be donated, then the donor atom must have at least one lone pair and the acceptor atom is accepting the electrons. So the acceptor atom must have at least one vacant orbital in the valence shell so that it can accommodate the electrons. Okay, also these two are the main conditions for coordinate bonding. Also there is a third condition. The third condition is that the lone pair which is donated by the donor atom and accepted by the acceptor atom, that lone pair should be equally shared between the donor and the acceptor atoms. Okay, so this is the donor atom, this is the acceptor atom. What is the first step? The first step is that the donor atom will donate one electron to the acceptor atom. As a result, there will be a positive charge on the donor atom and a negative charge on the acceptor atom because it has accepted one electron and it has donated one electron. In the next step, what will happen? These positively charged donor atom and the negatively charged acceptor atom will share one electron each to form the coordinate bond. So, the coordinate bond can be represented like this, or it can be represented like this. We generally represent a coordinate bond like this. So this is basically the mechanism of coordinate bond. Okay, so let's come to the examples. The first one is the formation of an addition product. This is ammonia. We know that ammonia is forming three covalent bonds with three hydrogen atoms and it is left out with a lone pair. Now I'll come to the next I'll come to is BF3. BF3. Look at this. Here, earlier also I have told you that boron is having incomplete octet. So boron is 2 electrons short of achieving its octet. So what will happen? The lone pair on this nitrogen will be transferred to boron. Okay, remember one thing, that when I was showing you that the mechanism of coordinate bonding, the first step I have told you that transfer of one electron takes place. So that the transfer of one electron means it is just like what happens in electrovalent bonding. And the second step is basically the sharing of both the electrons in the last. And that is, if this was same like that of electrovalent bonding, then this sharing of electron is same like that of covalent bonding. So coordinate bonding is basically a mixture of electrovalent as well as covalent bond. Okay. So I've just told you that. Okay. So I'll come to this again. Here the transfer of the lone pair on nitrogen takes place from nitrogen to boron. Okay, so this is the first step. And if this is done, then the second step will be the second step will be the sharing of this lone pair between nitrogen and boron. Okay? And this is how a coordinate bond is formed, and this is the structure of the addition product. The addition product is this. This is the addition product. This is how formation of an addition product takes place with the help of coordinate bonding. Okay. Next I'll come to the formation of fluoroborate ion. See, I will not come to the formation of ammonium and hydronium ion again, because this two you have learned in class 10 only. I won't come in this those two. Fluoroborate ion starts with boron trifluoride. See, again, boron trifluoride is 2 electrons short of octet. F minus. Lone pair is present on F minus. So this lone pair will be donated to the boron of BF3. So again, Okay, so this is the structure of fluoroborate ion. Which one we can write like this? BF4 minus. So this is how fluoroborate ion is formed. Okay, another example of coordinate bonding which I want to show you is of sulfuric acid. There is nitric acid also, but if you understand sulfuric acid, you will understand nitric acid also. Okay, sulfuric acid is one sulfur. Sulfur has 6 valence electrons. Four oxygens. Oxygens also have 6 valence electrons. Okay, so this hydrogen has one electron, this oxygen has 6 valence electrons. So if this hydrogen and this oxygen share one electron each with each other, then hydrogen will be duplet filled with 2 electrons and oxygen will gain one electron from this hydrogen. Now this oxygen, if shares one electron with the sulfur, then sulfur will also share this electron with the oxygen, then there will be a single covalent bond between the sulfur and the oxygen. The same case happens in the left hand side as well. So this oxygen only are 2 electrons short from achieving their octet. So, sulfur will donate its electron pairs to each of these 2 oxygens. Okay, so this is the next step where sulfur is sharing electron with this oxygen as well, oxygen with this hydrogen. All have completed their octet like this, and the last step is single covalent bonds. These 2 are coordinate bonds. This is the formation of H2SO4. Okay. If you want, you can show the unshared electrons also. Like this. Okay, so this is how coordinate bonding is formed in various molecules. Okay. So, after coordinate bonding, I'll come to that important part, which is certain bond parameters. means you have learned, you have heard about bond length, bond energy. What are these? Today in this video, I'll only teach you what is bond length and what are the factors on which bond length depends. In the next video, I'll start with bond dissociation energy and all. So, bond length. Now, what is bond length? These are the two atoms forming a covalent bond. This is A, so it is, its radii is RA, and this is B, so its radii is RB. Now, what is a bond length? It is basically the distance between the nuclei of the two atoms which have formed the bond. Okay, so if the entire distance is considered as D, if bond length is considered as D, then it will be equal to the sum of the covalent radii, RA plus RB. So this is bond length. Okay. Now I'll come to the factors that will affect bond length. See, the first factor is size of the atoms. The first factor is size of atoms. Now see, if the size of atom A and size of atom B were bigger, then obviously bigger sized atoms would have greater covalent radii. RA would be greater than that which is now, means it will be greater than what is now. So if RA and RB increases, then obviously their summation will also increase, means the bond length D will also increase. So with the increase in the size of the atoms, the bond length increases. The next factor is bond multiplicity. Bond multiplicity. What does bond multiplicity means? Here, normal single covalent bond is formed. Bond multiplicity means from single to double, double to triple. Means number of bonds between two atoms when increases. That is known as bond multiplicity. Okay. Normally single bond. Single bond length is greater than double bond length, which is greater than triple bond length. So with increase in the bond multiplicity, the bond length decreases. This is the second factor. The third factor is hybridization. Hybridization. Now, we all know that the s orbitals are closer to the nucleus. Nucleus, s orbital. So, the s orbitals are closer to the nucleus, which I have shown you that this is the nucleus, this is the 1s orbital. So the s orbitals are closer to the nucleus. So the nuclear effect on the s orbitals, or the nuclear attraction or the nuclear pull on the electrons on the s orbital, is much more as compared to p and d orbitals. So the hybrid orbitals, which have a greater percentage of s character, that hybrid orbital will be more attracted towards the electrons on those or hybrid orbitals will be more attracted towards the nucleus, and the bond length will decrease. So what I have told, that the s orbitals are closer to the nucleus, so the nuclear pull on the s orbital, electrons on the s orbitals, is much greater than that of p and d orbitals. And now in the hybrid orbitals means those orbitals having s and p and d orbitals together, those are known as hybrid orbitals, means the orbitals which are formed by the overlap of s, p and d orbitals, like sp3, sp2, sp3d. These are formed by the overlap of s, p and d orbitals, formed by the overlap of s and p orbitals. So they are known as the hybrid orbitals. So the orbitals which are the hybrid orbitals which have greater percentage of s character, the hybrid orbitals in which s character percentage is greater, that those hybrid orbitals will be, that means the electrons in those hybrid orbitals will be strongly pulled by the nucleus. As a result, the bond length will decrease. So sp3 hybrid orbital has an s character of 25%. sp2 has a s character of 33.33%, and sp hybrid orbital has a s character of 50%. So the bond length is shortest for sp, then sp2, then sp3. Bond length is shortest for sp, then sp2, then sp3. And the last factor is resonance. See, bond length also depends on resonance, hyperconjugation, aromaticity, all these factors. Why I am saying this? Because in benzene you will see the carbon-carbon double bond, in ethylene also carbon-carbon double bond, but the carbon-carbon double bond length in benzene is greater than that of ethylene. That is only because benzene is resonance stabilized. Benzene undergoes resonance. Okay, so the bond length also depends on resonance, hyperconjugation and aromaticity. Okay, so this was the first parameter, which was bond length. In the next video, I'll start with bond dissociation energy and bond angle. Okay, and then I'll continue with VACPR theory. I'll start with VACPR theory, in fact. Okay, so thank you.